There is nothing, absolutely nothing, half so much worth doing as simply messing about in boats. So said Kenneth Graham in The Wind in the Willows. The great resurgence of interest in our inland waterways as an invaluable leisure resource is a fitting celebration of over 200 years of canals in Britain. Just to step onto a towpath or steer along a cut is to break away from the modern pace of things and to take a step into history. The innovation of canals brought the great breakthrough of transport and communications, which paved the way for the Industrial Revolution. We must remember that the canals we use for leisure were built for work. A network of waterways to link industry with both its suppliers and its markets. Carrying coal to fuel the steam age, iron ore to feed the furnaces, limestone to help build new roads and to revolutionize agriculture. And for many different kinds of work, there were many different types of working boats. On the river navigations, sailing boats were the most common, troughs and barges on the Severn, flats on the Mersey and Weaver, keels on the Tyne and in Yorkshire, wherries in Norfolk, lighters on the Thames, and many more. They all differed in size and features. The inland canals relied in the main on horsepower. There were barges on White Canals, but the mainstay of the system were the horse-drawn boats working the narrow canals. The seeds for the great flowering of inland waterways in the 18th century had been sown many years before. The Romans had cut waterways. The first English canal is believed to have been the Fos Dyke, which connected Lincoln with the River Trent and was built in Hadrian's reign in the 2nd century AD. In the early 18th century, Britain was still largely agricultural, but a gradual movement from the countryside was beginning to take place, as industrial innovation provided the opportunity for employment and the possibility of higher wages. But to realise their full potential, new industries would need to have a reliable means of obtaining their raw materials and for distributing their finished products, and a system able to transport goods in ever greater quantities. At this time, roads were still largely unmade and often impassable in bad weather. The pack horse and teams of pack animals had been the chief means of transporting goods, but it proved a limited, slow and unreliable system. Breakages of fragile goods were very high. There was a need for an efficient boat transportation system. Tidal sections of rivers enabled coastal vessels to penetrate inland. However, at times of drought or flood, passage could not be guaranteed. Widening and deepening improved efficiency and allowed the use of larger boats. On the upper Thames, flash locks helped the passage over shallows. These were single barriers, not the kind of pound locks we know today. Boats were winched upstream through the lock, situated in a weir. Its beam was swung across the river, guide posts inserted, and bores were progressively pushed down between the guides until the flow of water was completely stopped. This led to a build-up of water above the lock, and enabled the craft to proceed further upstream due to the now increased depth of water, usually 2 feet or so. To go back down the river, boats would assemble above the lock, and as the boards, then the beam, were removed, rode the flood as the surge of water carried them downstream. It was the lie of the land which dictated the upper limit of navigation. If higher reaches could be linked by a totally artificial waterway, industry's needs would be met. Such a project would require men of vision, a great deal of money, and a new breed of civil engineer. The true birth of industrial canals dates from 1761, and the canal built for the Duke of Bridgewater. Francis Egerton, the Duke, had completed the grand tour on the continent and was impressed by the canals, particularly the Languedoc in France, which was independent of all rivers. He studied how to improve the transport of coal from his mines at Worsley in Lancashire to Manchester, some 8 miles away. With his agent, John Gilbert, he decided that the answer was to transport the coal in boats And in 1759, the Duke obtained permission to build a navigable cut, or canal, supplied with water drained from his mines. This ambitious project required the services of a skilled engineer. Egerton commissioned James Brindley, a Midlands millwright. Brindley's ability to make a success of any job he undertook, and his ingenuity in his engineering schemes for engines, mills, pumps, bridges, and other works, earned him the name of schemer. The Duke's Canal presented Brindley with huge engineering problems, not least how to cross the River Irwell. He decided to build a canal independent from all rivers, requiring no locks and also spanning the Irwell with an aqueduct, an idea regarded at the time as flying in the face of nature. The necessary Parliamentary Act was passed in early 1760 and the work commenced. The canal was operational by the following year. The Barton Aqueduct was 200 yards long, 12 yards wide, and was carried by a stone bridge of three arches at a height of 39 feet above the river. The centre arch had a span of 63 feet. It was described as the wonder of the age. The canal also featured extensive tunnelling at Worsley, eventually totalling 42 miles underground, bringing coal direct from the coal face. The dramatic result of the Bridgewater Canal's operation was to halve the price of coal in Manchester. Subsequently, the Duke sought to extend his canal across Cheshire to Runcorn on the River Mersey, giving access to Liverpool. The great potter, Josiah Wedgwood, had watched the progress of the Duke of Bridgewater's scheme with interest, recognising the great value a canal would be to the Staffordshire potteries. The new fashions for whiteware and china meant importing most of the pottery industry's raw materials from Cornwall and Devon. He was already moving for the turnpiking and improvement of roads to help with the passage of materials and goods. An enterprising plan was formed, again with the engineer James Brindley, to link with canals the four great navigable rivers of England, the Mersey, Trent, Severn and Thames, forming a Grand Cross. The backbone of the scheme was to be a Grand Trunk Canal, the Trent and Mersey, linking Liverpool and Hull, with other canals as branches to link up the greater part of the country south of the Trent with the ports of London and Bristol. The Trent and Mersey was a contour canal, as were all early canals. It followed the contours of the landscape, so avoiding the building of too many locks and conserving the water in each pound, or stretch of water between those locks which were necessary. But it required a long, straight and level tunnel of a mile and three quarters at Harecastle in North Staffordshire to complete the Trent and Mersey link. Engineering on this scale was quite unknown at this time. The tunnel was begun in 1766, but only completed in 1777, 5 years after Brindley's death. It was hailed as the eighth wonder of the world. In cutting it, many seams of coal and iron ore were discovered, and this led to further mining activity in the area. Coal, iron ore and clay extracted from enterprise were sold to help finance the work, whilst water draining from the mines ran directly into the canal tunnel, the iron ore giving the water a rusty colour. The achievement of the Trent and Mersey Canal, the grand trunk of the scheme, set the standard width for the narrow canal system with its 7-foot-wide locks and bridge holes. It was a catalyst for the great expansion between 1777 and 1800, when 60 different canals were authorised, both wide and narrow. This was canal mania. In 1793, speculation in canal building schemes reached its zenith. And in the 1 year alone, 24 acts for the construction of canals were passed by Parliament. Meetings to enlist subscribers to new canal projects were held all over the country, in pubs and halls, attended by hopeful investors who had travelled great distances in their expectation of making a quick killing. Huge sums of money were subscribed in single meetings, and bills for new canals at locations as diverse as Crinan in the west of Scotland, Llangollen in Wales and Gloucester in the southwest of England were steered through Parliament on a tidal wave of optimism. The more fanciful, unrealistic schemes foundered, but the canal system grew from 171 miles in 1770 to 1,584 miles by 1800, serving most of the major towns and cities in Britain. In 1793 alone, 62 different canals, a third of the entire navigable waterway system of Britain, were being worked on, the great bulk of canal construction being in the industrial Midlands. In the same year, the country's longest canal was sanctioned, with £600,000 capital. This was the Grand Junction, 93.5 miles from London to Braunston in Northamptonshire, engineered by William Jessop. It featured 100 locks, two long tunnels at Braunston and Blisworth, and served several branch canals. The world's largest ship canal was also sanctioned, the Gloucester and Sharpness. It took 24 years and great efforts to complete the 17.5 mile canal, 70 feet wide and 18 feet deep. It was the most accommodating canal in England and took boats carrying 600 tons of cargo. The other early ship canal, the Caledonian Canal in Scotland, engineered by Thomas Telford, opened shortly after. It linked the locks Lochy, Oyck, Ness and Dochfour to provide a safer passage for ships by cutting across Scotland through the Great Glen rather than sailing round the hazardous north coast. Within just three decades, from 1800 to 1830, it had become possible to move large cargoes over great distances. This was the canal boom. Industries, once small-scale and reliant on exhaustible local resources, were now able to import limitless supplies and, significantly, to grow and support larger communities. Villages grew into towns as a direct consequence of the canals. Through Wedgwood's foresight and enterprise and Brindley's grand trunk, the Trent and Mersey, the Potteries, for example, grew from a collection of separate villages to the world centre for ceramic production. No longer were building materials restricted to whatever could be obtained locally. Industries' raw materials and finished goods could be conveyed between factories, warehouses and ports, and manufactured items taken to the most profitable markets. Canal companies obtained parliamentary acts for compulsory purchase of land and water. Civil engineers such as Brindley and Smeaton, and later Jessop, Telford and Rennie, supervised the construction work. This was carried out by large gangs of labourers called navigators, or navvies, infamously celebrated in song and story. They were a mixture of English labourers, who had probably left the land because of the Enclosure Acts, plus many Scots, Irishmen and Fenmen, who were used to digging and embanking drains. A rough mix, possibly including many vagrants, the pick and shovel, the tools of their trade. These vast armies of navvies moved through the countryside, in many cases living off the land. Photographs of the building of the later Manchester Ship Canal in the 1880s give some idea of what was involved in constructing huge engineering projects in the days before the motorised earth-moving equipment we have today. Naturally, there was opposition. Landowners feared their fertile low-lying lands might be cut through and their water meadows drained. Local populations feared that the homegrown produce they relied on might be exported away from them. Mill owners feared loss of water from their streams. Road turnpike trustees saw a lowering of their tolls, and road carriers faced a loss of livelihood. Coastal trade saw a reduction in the amount of coal and goods carried by sea. There were bitter arguments in Parliament, but opposition had to give way to the inevitable progress. Inland canal ports were built to link the new inland waterways with coastal rivers and canals. Starport on Severn remains a classic example of a Georgian canal town, complete with unloading basins, warehouses, cottages for the workmen, pubs, mission halls and stables. Architecture to be repeated all over the country as more and more of the new revolutionary water navigations opened up the countryside and linked the manufacturing towns. Great engineering feats took the canals across difficult countryside, around and through natural obstacles. Brindley's Harecastle Tunnel on the Trent and Mersey, begun in 1766, had taken 11 years to construct. Subsidence around the turn of the century made a second tunnel necessary. Telford's companion tunnel alongside it took only 3 years to build, less than 50 years later. Such was the speed of progress in construction techniques. The standard width of a narrow canal was 30 to 40 feet. Boats on most Midland canals were 70 to 72 feet in length and 7 feet in width. They used lock chambers which were some 72 feet long and 7.5 feet wide, a standard set by James Brindley. Some later locks were built wider to accommodate a boat and butty. Locks are simple yet fascinating devices. By letting water run downhill, a boat can be made to go uphill. On average, a lock raises or lowers a boat between 6 and 10 feet, requiring about 25,000 gallons of water to do so. Whenever possible, Brindley followed the principle of having long stretches, or pounds, between locks to ensure a good volume of water and little effect on the level in the pound when a boat went through a lock. Where the level of a canal had to be raised or lowered through a considerable distance, a string of several locks was needed. Sometimes a staircase of locks had to be constructed, where the bottom gate of one lock was the top gate of the next one down, and so on. The time-consuming business of operating each set of lock gates had to be repeated many times. Locks rely for their operation on gravity, water pressure, and elbow grease. It was Leonardo da Vinci, in his capacity as ducal engineer, who invented the swinging mitre gate. James Brindley adopted, as his standard, double mitre gates at the bottom of a chamber and a single upper gate closing against a sill. Sluices, or paddles, opened and closed by a removable windlass operating rack and pinion gearing, control the flow of water into or out of a chamber, so raising or lowering a boat. The gates can only be opened when the water level each side of the gate is the same. A good push against the gate's balance beam then swings the gate open and allows the boat to continue on its journey. Some ingenious devices were constructed to transport boats from one level to another in much shorter times. There were structures such as the spectacular Anderton Lift, which raised craft in tanks 50 feet above the River Weaver to an aqueduct leading to the Trent and Mersey Canal near Northwich in Cheshire. It was designed by Edwin Clark for the Weaver Navigations engineer Sir Edward Leader Williams and opened in 1875. Originally operated hydraulically, it was converted to electrical operation in 1908. Inclined planes, such as this one at Foxton, also conveyed boats in tanks broadside up steep slopes. The long slopes and some of the guide rails can still be seen today, and this working model shows how the inclined plane operated. As one tank lowered boats down, a counterbalance tank brought other boats up the incline to the higher level. But for every spectacular feat of engineering, there had to be built thousands of what might be called everyday structures, from humble mileposts and bridge number plates to the bridges themselves needed to carry roads and farm tracks over the waterways. Bridges were sometimes brick, sometimes stone. Around Birmingham, for example, They were often made of cast iron, each proudly displaying the name of the ironworks that made them. There were lift bridges, swing bridges, and split bridges. Fixed bridges with a central gap for the towing rope to pass through. The most graceful design of all was the roving or turnover bridge, built at a point where the towing path changed from one side of the canal to the other. Its design allowed the towing rope to remain attached to both horse and craft, a clever idea that saved precious time. Where towing ropes rubbed the sides of a bridge, guards of cast iron were fitted as a protection. The rubbing of countless thousands of boat ropes in the past has left deep grooves plainly seen today. For busy commercial canals, it was crucial to have a good, reliable supply of water to the summit pound, the highest level on the canal. Water was lost through locks at both ends of the pound, and this water would have to be quickly made up, otherwise boats navigating the summit pound would eventually be left stranded in insufficient depth. There was a constant flow of water. The use of locks ensured this, and where locks stood unused for a time, bypass weirs allowed the flow of water to continue. Although rivers and streams could be tapped as common sources of water, water rights could be disputed, and so purpose-built reservoirs had to be created. Their capacities were not calculated in gallons, but in days. How many days' worth of supply to the canal each reservoir could hold? So, with sufficient funds, a good water supply, and a system of locks, a canal could be taken over higher ground on a direct route, rather than miles around it following the contours. Where too great a change in level was needed, it was often cheaper to make tunnels, which required less earth moving and construction by the navvies than making cuttings. Before boats had engines, they had to be legged through canal tunnels too narrow for a towpath. Sometimes there were gangs of professional leggers who could be hired to move boats through. They wore brass arm badges issued by the canal company to identify them. Brindley's Hair Castle on the Staffordshire Cheshire border was such a tunnel, although Telford's parallel tunnel incorporated a towpath. Legging boards were placed towards the front of the boat, extending out on each side. The leggers lay on each board and, by pressing their feet against the sides or roof of the tunnel, walked the boat through the gloom. In the meantime, the horse had been led over the hillside to meet the boat emerging from the other end. The majority of cuts were still contour canals, meandering around hillsides and using as few locks as possible to raise or lower the canal at key points. But greater engineering works were still being created. Cast iron was a revolutionary new material in canal engineering. Thomas Telford's magnificent aqueduct at Pontcassilty on the Ellesmere, now Llangollen Canal, was opened in 1805. It stands 127 feet above the River Dee. Its cast iron trough is 11 feet 10 inches wide, of which 4 feet 8 inches are taken up by the towpath. It's 1,007 feet long, supported on 18 stone piers embedded in sandstone rock. Masonry aqueducts need it to be over 20 feet wide, even to contain such a narrow channel. At Pontcassilty, the supporting pillars would have had to be so massive that they would have joined to create a dam-like structure right across the valley. The lightweight, half-inch-thick cast iron trough allowed Telford to create this elegant structure, dubbed the eighth wonder of the world, just as Brindley's Haircastle Tunnel had been 50 years before. From an engineering point of view, the aqueduct has never been surpassed. Here at the smaller Chirk Aqueduct on the same canal, we can see the railway viaduct alongside, a stark reminder of the threat of the railway age to the canal network. Horse towage was universal throughout the heyday of the canals, though sometimes mules and donkeys took the strain. All manner of cargoes were transported on the canals. An 1802 notice of rates of freight shows a typical selection carried by one firm alone on the Trent and Mersey through Staffordshire. This 1836 list, showing annual tonnage of goods and merchandise carried through Stoke-on-Trent, shows how effectively a typical urban conurbation was served by the canals. Lime and limestone too were important cargoes, carried on the Colden Canal from Froghall in the foothills of the Peak District onto the Trent and Mersey for the ironworks of South Staffordshire and the chemical industries of Cheshire, and further afield for use in the improvement of agricultural land. Many narrowboats only made short journeys and returned to their base before nightfall. Their cargo usually consisted of bulkier things such as coal or bricks, and they were worked by two men. Other narrowboats made longer journeys. They tied up every night at a wharf or convenient stopping place and moved on the next day. These were usually worked by a family who, in later years, would also live on board. Again, their cargoes were the bulkier goods. These were called slow boats or family boats. Flyboats were narrow boats which travelled by night and day, with the crew working shifts and changing horses along the route. The cargo was packages, crates, and occasionally passengers, and they had priority over other boats. Packet boats provided an express service, with lighter boats taking urgent packages and passengers. They usually ran to a timetable and used relays of horses like a mail coach. In general, boatmen were paid by the voyage, the payment depending on the type of cargo and the time likely to be taken to deliver it. The master, whether he owned a boat or worked for a carrying company, was paid a sum of money, out of which he had to pay those who worked the boat and feed the horse. Boats worked by a family didn't have an extra man or chap to pay. A father on family boats was by no means underpaid. His earnings were considerably more than most labouring men. However, a father who left his family ashore had to pay a chap to work with him, as well as pay rent for a cottage for his family. The factory inspector for Birmingham described the system in 1875. The women and children who travel and work with the slow boats are not employed by the canal companies, nor do they receive wages. The father undertakes the care of the boat during the journey and makes use of his wife and children to assist in steering and following the horse on the towpath. Children often commence to learn this work at the age of six. The father's wages average 20 shillings to 25 shillings a week after paying the expenses on the horse, and, of course, he has no rent to pay. In slack times, his boat may be tied up for a week while he earns nothing. Besides these slow boats, there are fly boats. The men in charge of these never take their wives and children with them. The master receives about £4, 17 shillings and sixpence a week and engages three men to help him, paying them about £1 a week. For these boats, the companies find horses. Early narrow boats had no cabins and were mainly worked by men and boys. But cabin boats and family boats became common when cutbacks came in as a response to loss in revenue to the railways. Boatmen and their families were forced to live on their boats as their wages were reduced and upkeep of cottages became impossible. Steam Tugs were introduced, capable of pulling up to 20 narrow boats through a tunnel, so putting some of the professional leggers out of work. Steam-powered narrow boats were introduced experimentally in the late 19th century, allowing engine boats to tow a companion boat or butty.
Initially, if you think that the first thing that towed boats was man, following that came the horse. The very next thing to the horse was the steamer. So they were the first boats that were actually pushed rather than pulled. And because of this, they could tow a butty behind, they could carry far more cargo. Problems arose with the butty as well. You could get 1.5 times the amount of cargo that you could tow with one horse. In addition to that, the boats were powerful enough where the waterways were big enough to tow 2 or 3 or 4 butties. This boat was built in 1909. The Fellows Morton Clayton steam fleet had been in existence since about 1885, 1890. So this boat was a fairly late addition, though she remained a steamer until 1925 when she was converted to diesel. The diesel engine only takes up a small amount of space. The boiler was no longer needed. Get rid of the boiler, put 8 more tons of cargo on, and cut down the number of people running the boat by 1. You didn't need an engine driver.
So, steamers were soon superseded by those with diesel engines early this century. The Swedish firm of Bolinder introduced a compact, reliable, slow-revving semi-diesel engine which quickly became popular throughout the system. But horse-drawn narrow boats were still in common use.
We used to, first thing, we'd give him his corn, water. That was before we did anything. Yours come first, always, because that's your living. Then you brush him down, then you put his gears on, and then you bring him out, you get your line, and you hook him to your line, you put your line on your mast, and then you start off whatever distance wherever you're going. The automatic comes to your father and mother, and when you're reared in it, it comes to you. That's my mother and father learned me and my brothers how to tie a rope, how to cloth a boat up, how to load your boat, how to store your stuff in it. You can have anything. We used to carry anything. Corn, sugar, milk, cartons of everything, even bales of dolls, paper, fruit, everything you wanted. Well, we used to cover, when I was with Fellows and Mortons, we used to go from Nottingham to Manchester or Preston Brook. We'd always have a load on. We'd empty Preston Brook or Manchester, then we'd go in the docks at Manchester, and then we'd load whatever, we'd go to Nottingham, Derby, Leicester, Coventry, Nuneaton, or even Birmingham. You see, the head office was in Birmingham, Fellows and Mortons. If you wasn't working, you got no money at all. You see, you got paid on your mileage. You got, if you was empty, you'd have 6 pence a mile. And if you had 10 ton, you had 9 pence. If you had 20 ton, you had 1 and a penny a mile. And then if you went down fly, if you was working all night to fly, you got 1/2 crown for you and 1/2 crown for the horse. That was 5 shilling.
Life on the boats could be hard. There were sinkings, there were accidents sustained in the use of necessary equipment, windlasses and ropes, for instance. The wet and slippery environment around locks and bridges was dangerous. At times, canals broke their banks disastrously. If a horse died, a family might lose its lifeline. And if the canal froze over in winter, boats could be trapped for days or even weeks before the ice was broken. On the ironclad boats used for ice breaking, 2 lines of men stood facing each other, grasped a central beam and rocked the boat from side to side as it was pulled along by a team of horses, ploughing through the ice and so keeping a canal open. On family boats, cabins were designed to allow a modicum of comfort and facilities through ingenious use of space. The average size of a cabin at the turn of the century was 8 feet 6 inches long and 6 feet 6 inches wide for families with several children. In the cabin, all their possessions had to be stored away and space used to the best advantage. The door of one cupboard folded down to form a bed, while another swung forward to make a table. Curtains with fine crochet work screened the sleeping quarters. Traditional lace-edged plates, ornaments, horse brasses and family photographs were all around, and a compact stove or cooking range became the focal point at mealtimes. The Canal 77 brought in regulations allowing only 3 or 3.5 adults occupying the cabin, a child under 12 counting as a half adult. After this, some boats were built with 2 cabins, the extra one in the bows used for sleeping only.
They could have probably 3 in there, and then you'd have 2 in the starn end, and then you'd have 1 or 3. You could have probably 5. If they got brothers and sisters and one family got a big family, we'll say overcrowded, so over 6, and then they'd say to the brother or sister, do you want so-and-so for work for you? And they'd bring that child up as their own.
Census figures for an 8-year period from 1851 show the numbers of men and women sleeping on board canal boats. Children weren't included. Boats and accessories were brightly painted, featuring the traditional roses and castles still seen today. Their origin isn't clear. Some historians claim it shows that boat people came from gypsy stock, but there's no real evidence that roses and castles are true Romany art.
I feel as though years ago, when the sign writers were commissioned to letter the side of the commercial boats, they found they'd got little blank spaces in corners, and a sign writer would put something in that corner. He seemed to have picked on roses at that particular time. And sign writers being great copiers, I feel as though another sign writer would see his work and say, I like that, I'm going to do that, I'll do that a bit better. And it went on from there. And I think that is basically how it all started. There's quite a range of styles, but I think you'll find every sign writer developed his own style. He never actually initialed his own style. You could turn around and say, I know that sign writer by the style of his rose.
You don't have to look for a signature at all, because you could tell his style, either diamonds, roses, or water cans. You could tell if a water can had been painted in Birmingham, Wolverhampton, or along the summit, or in Pottsies.
Rudders on butties and on horse-drawn boats were painted in a variety of ways, but usually in a geometric pattern. To the boatman, the rudder post was the ram's head, and a Turk's head of woven rope commonly featured on its top. Sometimes a white horse's or mare's tail was hung down behind it. Their tillers were 8-sided and carved from a single piece of wood. Intricate designs of rope work formed the boat's fenders at the bows and stern. Women wore ankle-length skirts, long, wide aprons, blouses with leg-of-mutton sleeves, shawls in cold weather, and white bonnets with stiff brims across in front, and a frill known as a curtain hanging over their shoulders, edged with crochet work. After Queen Victoria's death, some boatwomen wore black bonnets for many years. Boatmen wore flat caps, sometimes a bowler, and waistcoats, and many objected to being called bargees. Captains and mates often had company uniforms, waistcoats with velvet collars, striped shirts, special neckwear, corduroy trousers and braided braces. Their clothes gave them status, and status gave them identity. Some claimed a gypsy heritage for the people of the canals. Others that they came from sailing families, hence the rings in their ears and the love of polished brass and colourful decorations. Some social reformers thought the life on the canal created such problems that the children ought to be the target of missionary crusades. Colliery owner George Smith made exaggerated claims on the depravity of canal life, but his crusade led to the two acts in 1877 and 1884 which appointed a government inspector, John Bryden, to take steps to improve living conditions. Conditions did improve, and boatmen were proud to be treated as a useful body of men helping to carry on their country's commerce rather than being looked upon as gypsies or outcasts. The top men, the number ones, were the owner boatmen. Many did the same trip year in, year out, carrying the same goods. Some traded with only one customer, while others carried a paid agent who could find new customers for them. All were astute businessmen, always on the lookout for trade, particularly for return loads. Anything which could be bought, transported, then sold on at a profit. Despite claims of illiteracy and ignorance laid at his door, the boatman knew his trade and his craft and his routes inside out. He was familiar with the buildings along the banks of the waterways. He knew many of the people who lived or worked in them, lock keepers, toll collectors who gauged the load and took payment for use of their length of canal. Maintenance men and other canal workers were familiar, if only by nicknames, and canal-side pubs and inns were major meeting places.
When you worked on canals, you wasn't a stranger, because the towns you went through, the place houses, always houses on canal side, and then you got your lock keepers. Everybody knowed you. Chance went from one end of the canal to the other. And you got on with the town people or country people. Wherever you went, they used to give you anything. They'd do your washing for you, and then you pick it up, drop your washing off, and then you pick it up when you come past again. It was always helpful to the country people was and the town people.
One of the first carrying companies was Pickford's, who started out as, and still are, road hauliers. Their canal boat services were introduced around 1790. Fellows Morton and Clayton were another great firm of carriers. On the canals today, there are many reminders of carrying, but the sight of a loaded narrowboat is rarely one of them. It was the arrival of the steam locomotive which heralded their slow decline. The first direct competition came with the opening of the Liverpool and Manchester Railway in 1830. At this time, the bulk of industry's materials and merchandise was being moved by canal, and over 4,000 miles of canals had been cut. But the 1840s saw the dawn of the railway age and mid-century railway mania. In 1846 alone, the railways were authorised to build lines equal to the total length of the whole of the waterway system. Steam gave the railways the advantage of both speed and the ability to transport even larger loads. The navvies had a new lease of life, and the railway system would eventually extend to every corner of the land. New factories were drawn to the new fast freight services offered, but canal-side industry still had the majority of their supplies and goods transported by boat. Being slower than rail could also be of great assistance to manufacturers, since the boats were actually providing mobile warehousing. The short-haul mineral canals in the Midlands continued to win the battle to carry cargoes, but at the expense of charging lower tolls. Long-haul traffic suffered most. Necessary maintenance of locks and tunnels and other enforced closures only helped the drift of trade. The later canals had been cut straight, as opposed to the earlier contour canals, and these could compete more effectively using their flyboat system. The Birmingham and Liverpool Junction Canal, now the Shropshire Union, is a classic late canal. It goes through deep cuttings, along high embankments, across aqueducts, and in 22 miles has only one lock. Such were the advances in engineering over canals navigated only half a century before. It competed directly with the new railway links between the Black Country and Merseyside. And by now, Birmingham alone had more miles of canals than Venice. Trent and Mersey and the Shropshire Union represent the old and the new, the start and end of the canal boom. With the new railway age, many miles of canal soon became uncommercial. Those with many factories along their banks could still continue to prosper, but the system as a whole began to break down. Railway companies stepped in and bought up canal companies to eliminate competition, in some cases using their land for new routes. But not all railway companies had an active outlook towards attracting trade to the canal, and the resulting reduction in use brought about deterioration. This, in turn, discouraged traffic and led to a progressive running down of the system. The Manchester Ship Canal was built in direct competition to the railways. It opened in 1894 at a cost of almost £14.5 million, nearly twice the estimate given in the 1886 prospectus. The largest entrance lock to the canal at Eastham on the Mersey was 600 feet by 80 feet, the upper locks being 600 feet by 65 feet. Manchester's new access to the coast brought prosperity to the city, and by the turn of the century, there were acres of water space in the Manchester and Salford docks, with over 5.5 miles of quays. These developments, however, were exceptional, and various efforts were being made to halt the general decline of the canal system in the 1890s. The struggle was long and hard. In 1906, a royal commission urged the government to amalgamate and modernise the surviving canal companies, but their 1911 report was not implemented. And yet, although the system continued to contract and fragment, a substantial amount of material was still being moved by canal boat in the early years of the 20th century. Then the arrival of the motor lorry, which came into its own in the 1920s and 30s, ate further into markets. But entrepreneurs could still make a substantial living by operating fleets of boats on certain canals. And in the 1930s, the Grand Union Canal Company was established, an amalgamation of five companies which set about improving the route from London to Birmingham, spending £1 million in the process. By 1938, a fleet of 400 boats had been built up. Trade increased, but the company then suffered from shortage of boatmen. The decline this century can clearly be seen from the annual tonnage of goods carried on certain canals. In 1948, nearly all the canals, along with most of the fleets of boats, were nationalised under the British Transport Commission, together with the railways, docks and road haulage. Trade continued at a tolerable rate through the 1950s, with cargo being carried by the British Transport Waterways Division, remaining fleet carriers and the independent number ones, the owner boatmen. But by 1962, the picture had changed. Trade had dwindled, boats were old, many had been sold off cheaply, and money was scarce. Sometimes carriers didn't have enough boats to honour contracts, and those failing to maintain schedules only helped the drift towards road haulage. To make things worse, a 12-week spell of freezing weather in the early months of 1963 brought boats to a complete standstill all over the country. Trade was lost too when canal-side factories and collieries closed down. New factories looked for green field locations and an expanding road and motorway network. The number of boats being scrapped or scuttled rose dramatically. A government report of 1965 showed the canal system to have no standing in the economic marketplace of the 60s. This report appeared to provide a setting for the final chapter in the story of Britain's working canals. In point of fact, a fresh and hopeful chapter was already emerging. An Act of 1968 provided a new charter for the waterways, by now run by British Waterways, dividing the canals of the system into three groups. Commercial, some 300 miles. Amenity, specifying over 1,000 miles as cruising waterways for pleasure craft. And about 600 miles of remainder waterways, whose future was uncertain. As early as 1946, the Inland Waterways Association had been formed by writers Tom Rolt, Robert Aikman, Charles Hatfield and Frank Eyre to watch over what was happening to the canal network, and they campaigned forcefully to promote restoration and maintenance. Rolt's book Narrowboat had a profound effect in promoting new interest in the canals. Local authorities were petitioned to make them aware of the great amenity value of a healthy canal. Projects were soon underway to reverse the years of neglect. Naturally, there were many problems to overcome. Many lock gates needed repair, maintenance, or replacement. Water channels were choked with weeds, trees, and shrubs, and all kinds of rubbish thrown in over the years. After many years of campaigning and through the great efforts of British Waterways, supported by the work of the Inland Waterways Association, much of the canal system has been improved and refurbished. British Waterways owns most of the canal system and has a network of workshops carrying out construction, renovation and maintenance work. In addition to the Inland Waterways Association, canal societies established themselves to promote the restoration of individual canals, which they have done very successfully. Enthusiasts, teams from the Waterways Recovery Group, and young people gaining work experience on government training schemes are the modern navvies. As part of this dramatic change in the fortunes of the waterways, canal museums have emerged to celebrate the rich heritage of the canal age. The National Waterways Museum, established at Gloucester Docks, was opened by Prince Charles in 1988. Its displays of memorabilia, documents and visual material celebrate over 200 years of working canals.
Well, this was a corn warehouse, one of many built around Gloucester Docks. There are 19 listed buildings here, and most of those are corn warehouses. This was built 1873, it's the last one, and this would take, what, about five shiploads of corn stored here before it went off up to the Midlands to feed the growing industrial areas. There's a lot of things that go into a museum. We've got the displays, teaching really, it's our educational business, but of course the displays are backed up by an awful lot of research and people out around the canal system collecting items, researching items, getting photographs together, doing sound recordings, everything that goes into knowing about the history of 200 years of canals. Well, we have our own local boating community and they've reacted to what we've done on the Severn, because very few people had touched the history of the Severn and the waterways up to Cadbury's. We do get the Midlands boatmen down here, and they enjoy what they see. But we're telling a slightly different story. Stoke Bruin tells the story of the boat people and their painted wear and living on a cabin. We tell the story of how canals were built and how they go through the landscape.
The Stoke Bruin Museum, alongside the Grand Union, is based around a converted grain warehouse. At Ellesmere Port in Cheshire is the North West Museum of Inland Navigation. This was once a busy canal port where the Shropshire Union met up with the Manchester Ship Canal on the banks of the River Mersey.
It's at the Boat Museum at Ellesmere Port. It's one of the exhibits. There are dozens of boats up there from, 250-ton carrying downwards, down to the original sort of boats, the Starvationers that were used in the mines at Worsley right at the beginning.
Thank you.
it's a working museum piece. We try and portray it as it used to be used, towing a butty, carrying cargo. It presents a picture of yesterday on today's canals.
British Waterways Open Days, special events, and campaigning boat rallies are held throughout the country every year. The Inland Waterways Association's annual rallies attract several hundred boats and some 100,000 visitors, enjoying their contact with canals and canal boats. Millions now enjoy the peace and quiet pace of leisure, trips and holidays on the waterways. They may not be the focus of commercial mania that they were 200 years ago, but the canals have developed to become an important leisure facility and a vital link with Britain's industrial heritage. Strong enough and popular enough to flourish into another century.